So he's in the world, he's out of the world as and when necessary. Yatha kurmani kurma angani iva, he says. Samharate yada samharate chayam. How, like a tortoise, he can withdraw from the world? How, like the same tortoise, he can get into the world? Beautiful example. This is a person who has the wisdom. Get in, get out as and when necessary. Okay. Then going ahead, he says, now for after this, a few verses, he is not talking about now about the wise person. From 59th verse onwards, he is not talking about the wise person. From the 59th verse onwards, he is talking about all of us, okay, who are not wise. Okay, let us see that. Vishyaha vinivartante niraharasya dehinaha rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. Vishyaha nivartante. Sense objects nivartante, fall away. Niraharasya dehinaha, one who does not feed the senses. In other words, what he is saying is, as a choice, you can remain away from essential pleasure or anything for that matter. Any person can do this. As a choice, you know how not to get into anything. Like those who decide to fast. That day, no food, no problem. Okay. But he says, that's by choice. Therefore, Vishyavin, the object is kept away. But, Rasavarjam, leaving behind a rasa. There is a rasa for that object. Meaning, you are still looking at that object that you have withdrawn from as a source of joy. As a source of joy, you are still looking about it. Then rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. That rasa, that looking upon it as a source of joy, param drishtva nivartate. When you see the highest, that also goes away, he says. Param drishtva. When you see yourself as ananda sarupa, yourself as param brahman, then rasaha api nivartate. You are not looking at it as a source of ananda anymore. Until then, it will be a source of joy. After that, it will be like anything else. If there it is fine, not there it is fine. Okay. Non-binding nature, etc., that we have seen before. Okay. I think this is pretty simple, pretty clear. Okay. And next verse, next two verse, okay. He is sounding a caution here for the student, okay. Yatato hyapi kaunteya purushasya vipaschitah indriyani pramathini haranti prasabham manah. Yatataha api, even though he is a person who is striving for moksha, striving for this knowledge, yatato api, he kaunteya kunti putraha, purushasya vipaschitaha, of this person who is intelligent, who is capable of right thinking, etc., of this person, indriyani pramatini haranti prasabham manaha. Pramathini indriyani. The sense organs which are not been mastered, which are not been controlled, haranti prasabham manaha. Manaha prasabham haranti. It will forcibly take away the mind, he says. Why? Because you never controlled your sense organs. You never mastered your sense organs. You are too used to giving your sense organ whatever it demands. you are not in charge of your life, the sense organs are in charge. Yeah. Then what do? Master the sense organs. See, you are an intelligent person. You are following the path. You are listening to the Gita regularly. You are reflecting on it. You are doing some japa, etc. All that you are doing, you are putting in all the right efforts. But the mind is unbridled. Then for what? It can forcibly take your mind away, carry it away. Aaj chodo na, aaj so jao, forget the class. It's nice to get up and I go in for the class, but nicer to continue my sleep. The sense organs are, sense organs means your emotional setup is like that. Okay, yeah. Therefore, what to do? Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asit matparaha vashehi asya andriyani tasya prajna pratishtita. As against this, what is the wise person who has gained this knowledge? Tani sarvani samyamya, having mastered your mind and sense organs, he is a yuktaha now, a person who is together. Together means what? I tell the mind to go there, it will go there. Let's think about it. Okay, think about it. Forget it, that's not what, think about this. Alright. Hey, I want to go and eat that thing. Forget it, finish this work, then you can do that. No, I want to listen to some music. Forget it, finish this work, then you can do that. Hey, so much of work, mood nahi hai, forget mood, you are supposed to do something. Go ahead. So, a person who is like that, yuktaha, asid matparaha, that person is committed to me. Committed to discovering moksha. Committed to discovering that he is nothing but Brahman himself. Vasheyasi Indrani, for whom all the sense organs are in his mastery. Tasya prajna pratishtitaha. Very soon you will find his wisdom is steady, very clear. He has gained this knowledge. Therefore, what Krishna is doing here is highlighting the importance of self-mastery. For the wise person, there is an effortless, natural self-mastery. Effortless. Why? He has done it enough as a student. As a student, it is something to be cultivated and disciplined. Okay? You need to do that. You need to see that, okay, these are the areas where my mind doesn't listen to me. These are the areas where I give in too much to physical comfort and pleasure. Therefore, I learn to discipline it. Sometimes it's about saying no to yourself. Sometimes it's about saying yes to yourself. Fasting, etc. is a way of getting that discipline by saying no to yourself. Giving a commitment and doing whatever you can to keep it is about saying yes to yourself, even though you may not be in a mood for it. Both together gets you that mastery of the mind. Once that is done, you are a competent person, competent to know the truth and make it a fact of your life. Okay? Alright. Going further, he is giving you what is very popularly known by the modern teachers as the ladder of fall. Okay, there is no real falling on the spiritual path. Okay, there is no real falling, but you, that's where it's expressed sometimes. Okay, what is that? Okay, dhyayato vishyan pumsaha sangasteshu upajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha kamat krodho abhijayate krodhat bhavati sammoha sammoha moha smriti vibhramaha smriti bhramshat buddhinashaha buddhinashat pranishyati. Okay, dhyayato vishyan pumsaha sangaste shupajayate. Okay, you're thinking of something. जस्ट अ फैंसी. ध्यायतो विषयान पुंसा, दिस पर्सन थिंकिंग ऑफ समथिंग, हे दैट इज नाइस. यू सॉ समथिंग इन अ शॉप विंडो बिफोर द लॉकडाउन, मे बी अ न्यू पेयर ऑफ शूज, मे बी अ न्यू ड्रेस, मे बी अ न्यू बाइक, मे बी अ न्यू कार, वॉट एवर, यू सॉ इट. देन वॉट? देन यू पास अप एंड डाउन. एवरी टाइम यू आर पासिंग अप एंड डाउन, यू आर वेटिंग एंड हैविंग अ लुक एट इट. प्योर विंडो शॉपिंग. संघ तेषु जायते, देयर इज अ संघ नाउ यू आर डेवलपिंग, एन एसोसिएशन, जस्ट एन एसोसिएशन, बिकॉज यू देयर इज अ फैंसी, यू ओके, यू सी इट अ फ्यू टाइम्स. वेन यू एवर यू पास दैट शॉप, यू आर लुकिंग इन टू इट. संघा संजायते कामः. देन now what? You are in lockdown, but that sangaha is there. You are now that mentally thinking about that nice stuff that you saw. From that sangha jayate kamaha, desire, you can't get it. Lockdown now, hell yaar. Kamat krodha vijayate, from that desire, whatever is preventing you to get that object of desire, you get angry. Why is the government like this? Lockdown has served its purpose. Why don't you ease up and open up the shops? Why? Just because you have a desire for something. You will target anything and everything. Because your karma couldn't be fulfilled, you are targeting a government for what it is doing. Most people are like that. Okay, when you see people ranting and raving against a thing, it is just that. Kamat krodha abhijayate. If your kama cannot be fulfilled, whatever stops you from fulfilling that kama, krodha abhijayate. Or you look upon yourself as a very spiritual person and you don't like that desire, you'll get angry at yourself, which is worse. Okay. Either way, क्रोधः अभिजायते, क्रोधात् भवति सम्मोह. सी ही शोइंग यू अ सडन पैटर्न ऑफ थिंकिंग. दिस पैटर्न कैन बी ब्रोकन एट एनी प्लेस, दैट्स व्हाट ही वांट्स टू हाईलाइट, बट ही शोइंग यू द पैटर्न. क्रोधात् भवति सम्मोह, फ्रॉम क्रोध देयर इज अ सडन अमाउंट ऑफ डिल्यूशन, देयर डिल्यूसरी थिंकिंग फ्रॉम क्रोध. सम्मोह स्मृति विभ्रमः, फ्रॉम दैट डिल्यूशन your memory is gone. Memory meaning of what you are supposed to be, etc. gone. Your heritage, what you stand for, your role in life, all that gone. Spruti brahmshad buddhi nashaha. When you don't have a reference point of the memory of who you are, what you are, then buddhi nashaha, your viveka, buddhi here means viveka, your viveka is gone. And buddhi nashad pranashyati. You'll do all the wrong things. You'll do all the wrong things. The world is full of examples of people who are good human beings who got waylaid by something like this and became criminals also. If you look at, for example, some of the terrorists, including the one who was killed recently in Kashmir, maths teacher, encouraging students, he was very attached to all his students. One of them died in a crossfire. Anger came up. Look at it. One kid should not, it's a very unfortunate thing, okay? It should not have happened. But collateral damage happens. If the situation is akin to war, it happened. should not have happened, or did it happen? Anger comes up because the kids that I loved, one of them died. Krodha. From Krodha, delusion. Smriti Vibhrama. I am a teacher, I am supposed to be nurturing students and gaining. I should be helping the other students who are feeling the grief, etc. All that gone because of that anger and that delusion. And he, Buddhinashaha. Because of that, Buddhinashaha. Buddhinashaha, he became a terrorist. From where to where? Someone who is a nurturer. Someone who helps people grow. Understand the intricacies of mathematics. Intellectual there. And rather becoming a terrorist? Extreme case, because in an extreme example, it's easier to understand. But sometimes we get angry over family, relatives, neighbors, etc. on simple thing like this, and we end up a fight and don't speak to them for next 10 years. Why? Simple. Some desire not fulfilled. Anger. Delusory thinking. Smriti nashaha, buddhi nashaha, pranasha. Relationship gone. Something simple. Because once the track is set, you don't know where to cut it off. You don't know how to break it. At any stage it can be broken. Sangha stage it can be broken. Kama stage broken. Forget it, not worth it. Or get it with karma yoga buddhi, prasada buddhi, etc. So even if you don't get it, you'll be okay. No, it became anger. You recognize that anger. Handle that anger, break that anger. Once delusory thinking, from anger comes delusory thinking. Okay, here you require some help, talk to a friend, etc. to put you on the right track. Once Smriti Vibhramaha, Smriti Nasha, Buddhi Nasha has happened, then nothing much can be done. Buddhi Nasha also something can be done. But you need somebody who will confront you and put you on track. Until delusory thinking, there's a lot you can do by yourself. After that, you may require some help. But at any stage, it can be broken. The sooner you catch it, the easier it can be done. You know, people come and I get this all the time. Mistakes done, relationships spoiled. They tell me, Swamiji, what to do? It happened. Nothing happens by itself, okay? Nothing happens by itself. There's always this process of thinking involved. Dhyayana, Sangha, okay, Kamaha, Krodha, all this, there is this. Yeah. You loved a man and married him. All the time I am making the men the perpetrator. So for a change, it'll be men make the woman the perpetrator. This woman loved this guy and married him. Then got attracted to somebody else. Sangaha, Kamaha. But you can't be with that person because I'm married to this guy. Therefore, Krodha, anger. Things which was not irritating before becomes irritating now. Things which was very, you know, this, everyone has some idiosyncrasies. Everyone has some silly aspects to their personality. Which was charming before, now becomes what? Idiot. Krodha. Relationships go sput. Don't tell me it happened. Doesn't happen by itself. Always a process happens. You can always break it if you want to break it. If you want to break it, you can break it. Yeah. I'm not talking about right and wrong. I'm just talking about a pattern that can be broken or encouraged or outlawed. You can love the world. There's no problem about it. What you do is an issue. What you destroy is an issue. Loving the world is not a problem. What's the problem? then the next verse is these are two verses. Any questions up to now, or is it clear? Any questions, any disagreements, anything that you want to add, cut, chop? Hello, yes? Clear or no? You have a question?
Yeah, one small clarification
from louder, please.
One small clarification, Swami.
Yeah.
You mentioned Sangha.
What is that?
Sangha, you mentioned.
Sangha, yeah?
Yeah. So, one small thing, I wanted to check. What exactly Sangha means?
Okay, Sangha means an association that you develop. Okay? Because you're thinking of it, you develop some sort of a connection with it. If you keep thinking about it, you feel a connect with the thing. Look at it. Two strangers come together and work on a project together. Okay. Two strangers come together and work on a project together. After some time of working, you are only colleagues, but you have developed a connect with the person. No? That connect is called Sangha. It's a nice thing. Sangha by itself is good. If it develops into affection, friendship, comradeship, teamwork, it's all beautiful. Then there is no issue about it. That connection is talking about Sangha, which can go into karma. Need not go, but it can go into karma. If it is two single people getting into karma, there is no problem again. What is the problem?
Yeah.
And somebody asked a question, is rasavarjam same as a desire? Okay. Rasavarjam is not exactly as a desire, more so as a logical and an emotional value for what you have given up. That emotional thing that you feel, arey, if it was there, I would really enjoy it, but I have given it up now. That type of a feeling is called rasa. That this, it will give me a great joy. Like how, on the day you are fasting, you are thinking of your favorite food. That is called rasa. What is left behind? Then somebody said, we have so many of desires. How do you know which will lead for anger? The stronger the desire is, and the greater the opposition to fulfilling that desire is the one that will trigger anger in you. Against whatever is opposing the fulfillment of the desire. The chance of desire. You can master your anger right there and say, no, I will work creatively towards fulfilling the desire. You can do that. It doesn't have to go into that. He's showing a pattern of thinking that happens with most people. So what is my strongest desire? And, hey, my strongest desire is this, but my people are happy with it. My strongest desire was to become an engineer and my people were very supportive. Then what is the problem? But look at it. Your strongest desire was to become an engineer. And because of some reservation policy of the government, you couldn't get a seat. Now it will become anger against that whole reservation policy. I am not justifying it or I am not criticizing it. The policy exists. There is a logic for it. There is a logic against it also. Both exist. But because you lost that seat, you will rant and rave against the whole reservation policy. You will not be looking at other creative ways of fulfilling your desire to become an engineer. There are so many ways of doing it without that. But because you lost a seat, your anger against the reservation policy, your anger against the government, your anger against the backwards, all of it will be. No justice in our system, you know. Indian system, there is no justice. I better go abroad. Go. better that you are not here. Are you getting what I am trying to say? Hey, you have understood what I am saying? Or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. How to identify the most pressing desire? It is your desire. You should know how strongly you want it. Now, if the desire keeps changing, okay, today you got a phone call from one person, you think you are in love with her. Evening you got a phone call from somebody else, you think you are in love with her. At dinner you met somebody else, you think you are in love with her. That means you are not in love with anybody, you are in love with your idea of love, that's all. It is your desire. You should know what is it that you are desiring or not desiring. How can anybody tell you this is your stronger desire? You know what is your strongest desire. If you don't know, then sit down, spend some time thinking what will happen to me if I get it, what will happen to me if I don't get it. Your response to these two will tell you whether it's a strong desire or not. What will happen to you if I get it? I'll be happy. Ah, good, nice. What happens if you don't get it? Oh, nothing, it's okay. That means the desire is not strong. No, I'll feel miserable about it. That means the desire is strong. No, I want it. Good, then work for it. Karma Yoga Buddhya, work for it. Is that clear? You can respond in a message if you don't want to respond. Yeah. Okay. Now somebody asked, is Sangaha the same as attachment? It can become attachment. Okay. Can become attachment. But it is a state, actually speaking, it is a state before attachment. That connect that you feel, physical and emotional connect that you feel with someone or something. That emotional connect that you feel, that is Sangaha, which can become attachment, can become desire, whatever, can become love. What you all say, I have good feeling about this? Yeah. It may be purely delusory, but you feel that. Purely it can be delusory. Yeah. That emotional connect that you feel may not be real. It doesn't have to be real. The object of desire need not be what you think it is for it to become desirable. You only have to think it is like that to be desired.
Swamiji, when do you know it's real?
Huh?
When do you know it's real?
When do you know what is real? The object of desire? When do you know what is real?
The emotional connection.
Emotional connect is as mithya as your mind. Remember Satya Mithya that we discussed?
Yes.
Yeah? Emotional connect is purely emotional. How real do you expect it to be? How real do you expect an emotional connect to be? Only emotional, not more than that, isn't it? An emotional connect is an emotional thing. How real is your emotion? And only a connect, nothing more than that. Is nothing something big. Just a connect, you feeling. It is not that what we say, I feel connected to this very person very strongly, I want to marry her. That stage, you have gone from connect to desire to karma to love, etc. You have developed a long way. This word connect I am using is only at the starting level. You feel, ha, this is nice. This person is nice. This object is nice. That's all. A positive reference point you are having. Yeah. Okay, if desire arises from the Sangha, where does aversion comes from? Aversion also comes from the same Sangha to the opposite. The aversion can come, need not come, but it can come to the opposite. The same thing, the process is the same, reverse process. In the sense, here, if I get it, I think I'll be happy. In aversion, if I get it, I think I'll be miserable. Yeah, it's a value judgment both the places. Both the places, there's a value judgment. That value judgment has happened in both the places. And there is some Sangha in both the places.
Okay,
because without feeling some feeling, you cannot feel either way. No? Yeah. Therefore, aversion also is the same thing. Raga or Dvesha, both are the same. Raga or Dvesha, both are the same.
Swamiji, I have a question.
Yeah, what is the question?
Swamiji,
louder, please.
Yeah, sure. First, we are seeing, appreciating the process that is leading to growth and more.
Sir, you're too soft, sorry.
Okay, Swamiji, can you, is it okay now?
Huh? Better.
This is okay. So, in this verse, there is a process. Sorry.
Yeah.
So, one step, one thing leading to another. So, so basically, what you're saying is that Nirinthaya and Sangha, Vipama, and then further leading to Rodha.
Yeah.
But, there are many, like I think we have discussed in the previous class also, to explain.
It doesn't have to happen, yeah. You can break it at any time.
There are many instances in which there are rishis who suddenly explode with anger, like you were mentioning.
There are rishis who are?
Who explode with anger.
I told you that it is just with a rishi or a wise person that anger coming, this is not the process there. It's just a momentary thing that is coming in. We are not talking about the moment. We are not talking about a rishi or a wise person. We are talking about the common man. So the same comparison cannot be made. In a rishi or something, okay, you have seen some people, you ask them anything, but their first response is no. Do you not know that? You know, hey, cup of coffee? No. A drink? No. Shall we go? No. Anything, the first response is no. Why? It's just a habit. If you ask him again, he'll say, yeah, I'll have a cup of coffee. It's just a habitual response. Similarly, sometimes, in the way that you have lived in your past experiences, your habitual response may have been anger. I know wise people like that, whose habitual response in their Purvashrama, before they were wise, their habitual response was anger. They have broken this pattern of desire and anger and all that thing they have broken. That habit of anger they have not broken because they didn't give it enough time and attention. They could have broken it very easily, just like a habit. They could have broken it. They didn't break it. For whatever reason known to them, they didn't break it. Therefore, even after wisdom, they may have a habitual response of anger. But that habitual response of anger is very different from a real anger. Because if you are really angry at somebody, then you will carry it in your heart for a long time, isn't it? You will be plotting for what to do, how to respond, how to tackle this guy. A wise person, anger is not like that. It erupts, comes for a moment, it's gone. Next minute, he's okay, he's fine. Swami Chinmayanji was a classical example. 1 minute angry, next minute, few seconds back to normal. In fact, last class I said this. You know, you would erupt with something. Then someone like me will wait and says for the eruption to die down. Then I'll say, Swamiji, it's not like that, it's like this. Oh, why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you tell me? Everyone will keep quiet. So once when he said that, I said, Swamiji, how can I tell you when you are in erupting volcano? people around thought I would be finished. He laughed uproariously. He says, that is true. When I get angry, I'm like a volcano. But you know, it is, the next minute I'm okay. I said, Swamiji, I know that. That's why I said this. Because next minute he is really okay about it. He's not carrying it in his mind and remembering it for the next 5 years. He's not thinking of it for the next 5 minutes. 1 minute is gone. So that is just a habitual response. That doesn't follow this pattern. This pattern he's talking about is for the common man. And the common man also can break it. It's not that it has to go like this. He's saying it because you are capable of breaking it. If you are not capable of breaking it, what's the point in saying it? It's fact. It's what will happen. No, I wanted something. Desire came up. I'm working to desire for it. People are obstructing it. I need not respond in anger. I can respond creatively to find different solutions for it. Prasada buddhya, I can work for it and accept, okay, maybe it's not meant to be done. Okay, accept that. It's okay. I can. Therefore, various responses are possible. If you are aware of the pattern of what the mind unthinkingly follows, this pattern he is talking about is an unthinking pattern that happens in people. A mechanical pattern that most people follow. I mean, that the terrorist was shot a couple of days back is a classical example. A nurturer becoming a terrorist, come on. What can be more tragic than that? If he had taken care of his grief, even if he had done something positive like Human Rights Commission or gone to the court or tried to understand how the army also could not help it happening, how the soldier who fired that tear gas shell is also in grief, why did this child have to die? Why did he have to be caught in crossfire? You know, he is not seeing that part of it. The soldier is also in grief. You think a soldier likes to kill a kid? If he doesn't suffer from PTSD, it is surprising. So, he also is feeling, but he didn't, all this awareness was not there in him. A student of mine, or a student like mine, has been killed, therefore anger, unthinking. Poor guy, I have a sympathetic this for him. But once he has become a terrorist, the sympathy, etc., is useless. You can't do anything about it. Except what the security officers had shoot him down. Unthinking patterns these are. It is this unthinking pattern that one needs to break. Best places between the desire and anger, that part. Because desire we cannot help, no? We are human beings, we will have desire. Anger also we will have. But that connection, there, if we catch it at that level, a lot of things can be done. At the level of desire and anger, if we catch it, a lot of things can be done. After that, we require help. Up to here is easy to do it on your own. Not easy, but it can be done on your own. And there has gone more than that. You need some help, someone to put it in perspective for you. Somebody to help you understand things. But this level, up to this desire, anger level, we can handle it, take care of it. And that's important to take care of it. If you don't take care of it, then once anger has taken hold, smriti nasha, buddhi nasha, all that thing, it's a natural this. How many paper reports you read? In anger, he hit his friend and the friend died. It's a friend, a buddy. Momentary anger. Why? No control. Even if you don't have sama. Sama is mastery of the mind. We have discussed the qualities for a student. Sama is mastery of the mind. Dama is mastery at the physical level. Even if my mind control is lost, at the physical level I can say, no, hold it. My fists are clenched, but I will not hit. I will hold it back and open up the fist and take a few deep breaths. Even if that can be done, the pattern can be broken. And it's important to break that pattern. That mechanical pattern that happens, it's important to break it. Now, our responses may not be so extreme, but how many times we have had fights with loved ones, and that especially now in lockdown, and the sorry, I did not mean that. If you didn't mean it, why didn't you say it? And then that friction goes on, you keep poking and poking and poking. And then you don't know how to stop or how to break it again. Endless mechanicalness of thought and behavior. That's why I said right in the beginning, if there is one sadhana for a student of Vedanta, it is to be alert and deliberate in what the person is thinking or doing. To be alert, to be deliberate in what you're thinking and doing. If that is there, if you're alert to what's happening inside, if you're alert with respect to your actions, a lot of patterns you will be aware of yourself and you'll be able to break it. Why am I going into this unproductive thinking? Why am I going into this reactionary behavior? I'm supposed to be acting, not reacting. Why am I getting into that? You'll be able to think and act and take care of it. Therefore, to be self-aware, aware of what you're thinking, aware of what you're feeling, aware of what you're doing, and to be deliberate in your thinking, your feeling, your doing. That is one of the real important sadhana, because we don't give any sadhana in Vedanta. I've asked you to sit down and do a puja or do a japa or something. No. This is the sadhana, because Vedanta is 24/7. Ishwararpanam prasada buddhi 24/7. This alert living 24/7. To live alertly. You know, this is something that my guru told me when we were in the ashram, all of us. He addressed the class and he was saying, follow vak tapas, he said. What is vak tapas? That your word is sacred. You will never say, I did not mean it. Because if you did not mean it, you won't say it. You won't make a mistake in terms of what you say. You'll be very alert to what you're saying. You'll not have to take back your words. And a word given is a word kept. He says, follow this. Because if you're very alert to what you're saying, you're alert to what you're thinking. If you're alert to what you're thinking and saying, you'll be alert to what you're doing as well. This is vak tapas. One aspect of vak tapas is this, to be alert to what you say. You won't say things just to get away, just to handle an unpleasant situation. When you're cornered, you won't bluff your way out. All these things become part of it. Not easy, because you're not trying for something small. You're aiming for the moon. Bigger than the moon. You are aiming for being the infinite being itself. You are aiming to discover that you are that limitless consciousness. That's why he painted the picture of what you can be, this wise person. Prajahati, Yada, Kaman, etc. All that picture was painted. So that this is what you can be. Each one of us, this is what we can be. Therefore, it is worth trying. It is worth being alert, etc. It is worth doing whatever it takes. Lockdown or no lockdown, doesn't matter. Any questions or clarifications? Or is it clear? In my profession, I do knowingly say things. Why should you knowingly say things which you don't mean? You don't have to. You don't have to say everything. You don't have to reveal your trade secrets. You don't have to reveal your professional secrets. But that doesn't mean you have to bluff or lie. Yeah. You don't bluff or lie. Why do you have to bluff or lie? Certain things you don't reveal. Yeah. Promoting a product which we know is not best fit for a client, that is bad marketing. The client will not come back. You will not gain customer loyalty. If you are promoting a product to a client and the client that is not good for the client, believe me, the client will not come back to you. It's bad marketing. You will never gain customer loyalty like that. Tell him honestly what is the best product for him. Even if it is our competitors, it doesn't matter. Why? He'll remember you as a person he can trust and come back to you when he has a new need. Why? Because you are trustworthy. You have made yourself credited, trustworthy. You have shown him that you are a well-wisher. Chances are good that he'll come back to you. Or tell him honestly, these things of what you need, this product will meet, these things it will not meet. Be honest about it. And 80% will be met, 20% will not be met. Therefore, you can make up by that 20% by doing this. Even that, very often the customers will be happy with. But to bluff and make a sale, you'll make one sale, but you lost a customer forever. Because he'll remember you as someone who's bluffed and cheated. Bad marketing. Very bad marketing. Please don't fall into that trap. Not worth it. Not worth it. Yeah, you may meet your target for that quarter. That's all. At the most, the maximum gain you will get is you have met your target for that quarter. But life is not lived in a quarter. You don't do your career planning in quarters. Your career planning has to be over 20 years. Not one quarter. True, 20 years may be made up of quarters. But if you lose your customers in the second quarter, what is the point in having him in the first quarter? And he's never going to come back. If he is happy with you, he may or may not talk about it. If he is unhappy with you, guaranteed he'll talk about it. So you lose a lot. If the organization's policy is to promote a product, promote it to those people whom it will help. A product is made keeping some people in mind, some requirements in mind. So promote it to those people, don't promote it to those who will not help, number one. But if the company is completely false, then it's time to look. Do you really want to be associated with a company that is doing something completely unethical and immoral? And when the company goes down, do you want to be searching for a job, telling people you are coming from a company which is unethical, immoral, etc.? Even other unethical companies will not hire you. Therefore, think. Okay, we covered a few things. Good place to stop. Next class, we will see more. Om Tat Sat.